And the final item of business this evening is a member's business debate on motion 11114 in the name of Stuart McMillan on Children's Grief Awareness Week 2023. The debate will be concluded without any questions being posed, but I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons, and I invite Stuart McMillan to open the debate around 7 minutes. Mr. McMillan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. First, I'd like to thank colleagues for signing the motion and for those who are going to speak today. I'm certainly humbled to bring such an important debate to the Chamber today. As I mentioned in the motion, the Childhood Bereavement Network informs us that 62% of children in Scotland have lost a close family member by the age of 10. Almost two-thirds of children in our primary schools will have lost a mother, a father, a sibling or a grandparent in their young life. That is a very sobering statistic, but one that we all need to be cognizant of, as death and bereavement is a harsh reality of life. It's incumbent upon us all to do what we can to support young people when they are dealing with a bereavement, but also to, I believe, ensure that our young people have a level of resilience to actually help them deal with any trauma that may befall them during their formative years. And I want to go into why I've brought this debate to the Chamber today. I've spoken about an incredible person in the Chamber before, and I am pleased to actually be able to do so again today. Ben Kane is a young man from my constituency. He set up a bereavement support group in a school, Clydeview Academy in Gourock, after he himself suffered the loss of a loved one. Ben received support from the local organisation Mind Mosaic Child and Family Therapies, based in Greenock, and his support worker suggested that it might be of use to him and others if he started a support group. And that is exactly what Ben did. It's now been running for 2 years, and although Ben has now left school and is studying politics at Glasgow University, with an eye on actually sitting in one of these seats at some point in the future, several other pupils have kept the support group running. And to me, this highlights the need for such groups. And I understand it will be difficult for young people going through bereavement to contemplate setting up a group like this. But if they do, Clydeview Academy in Gourock is the example to follow. Unfortunately, there will always be more young people experiencing grief that will ensure that the group keeps going. I thought long and hard about how to approach today's debate, as I'm speaking about death, loss and grief. And no one relishes discussing these particular subjects, but I wanted to find a balance between being respectful to the issue, but also making the most of vital parliamentary time to debate this subject and hopefully make life just slightly a bit easier for our young people who are grieving today, tomorrow and also in the future. And that's why the work undertaken by Ben and his fellow pupils to support themselves while supporting others is so, so important. According to a study by the Children and Young People's Centre for Justice and the University of Strathclyde, more than half of Scottish children have experienced bereavement of a close family member by the age of 8. And the study was published in 2020 and does not capture the effect of COVID. And I think we can all expect this figure now to be somewhat higher. And as we know, COVID affected our young people very acutely, and whilst focused on bereavement so far, the motion is entitled Children's Grief Awareness Week 2023, which runs from the 16th to the 23rd of November. Children across Scotland, indeed the world, struggled being locked down in their homes, learning virtually, not being able to see their friends. Now, many of them will have lost a friend or a family member, and the grieving process would have been so much more challenging for them going through that COVID period. Now, being aware of and cognizant of children's grief is even more necessary in a post-COVID world. We know that the health services to support children are stretched, and the pandemic has placed a lasting strain upon our NHS. And that's why I believe the theme of this year's week is very apt, and it's the shape of your support. And with the focus being on the people around a bereaved child or a young person, beyond their friends or family, who can be there to support them through their grief, with the key question being asked, who else can you ask for help or support beyond your friends and family? Now, Ben's support group in his old school answers this question. Now, all of us speaking in today's debate are helping to advance the aims of this year's theme. And Child Bereavement UK are also there to offer that help and support. Now, they have a dedicated phone line, 0800 02 888 40, and can offer telephone or face-to-face support for bereaved young people and also their parents. And Child Bereavement UK helps families to rebuild their lives when when a child grieves or when a child dies. And the charity supports children and young people up to the age of 25 when someone important to them has died or is not expected to live, and parents and the wider family when a baby or child of any age dies or is dying. The Child Bereavement UK also provides training to professionals in health and social care, education and the voluntary and corporate sectors, equipping them to provide the best possible care to bereaved families. The charity has set up 11 regional bereavement networks for professionals across Scotland who work in the statutory and also third sectors, as well as business that support people with bereavement. The networks are also open to campaigners and activists, and the voice of lived experience is crucially important in these networks. Sean Humphreys, the Child Bereavement UK National Development Coordinator for Scotland, is responsible for the facilitation and development of these networks, and he is currently looking to establish further networks in Argyll and Bute and also in the Borders to try to ensure that even more coverage of all parts of the country. He's keen to hear from anyone who wants to be part of the existing or new networks. And if anyone living in these areas is interested in helping set up a network, please contact my office and I can put you in contact with Sean. On the 5th of December, all members of the networks are invited to join them for a national network event and training day where the theme will be on how they've adapted services to meet the changing needs and as how we grieve has changed over recent years, taking into account COVID-19 and associated restrictions and also the cost of living crisis. In 2022, Growing Up Grieving, the National Childhood Bereavement Project's final report was published and submitted to the Scottish Government. And earlier this year, I asked the Scottish Government when it would respond to the recommendations in the report, which included, and I quote, embedding commitment to improve support for bereaved children and young people into wider national priorities, promote greater awareness of children and young people experiencing grief, and to establish a national secretariat for childhood bereavement. I would ask the Minister to update the Chamber today regarding when the Scottish Government will respond to all of the recommendations in the report. And I want to thank also the Church of Scotland for their communication about the Reverend Fiona Gardner and the book that she has written entitled Love Songs for Healing and Hope. The proceeds of the book will be donated to two Christian charities, helping people, including young people, deal with grief. The two charities are Quiet Waters and Richmond's Hope. So come back to the work being undertaken in one constituency. And before closing, as part of the Inverclyde Bereavement Network, Ben Kane has arranged for the network's next regular meetings to take place this Friday to coincide with Children's Grief Awareness Week. And the meeting will specifically focus on bereavement from a young person's perspective. And Ben himself has already taken on board the recommendations in the Growing Up Grieving report. And Ben asked me to conclude the speech in this way. He wanted me to mention how Inverclyde has come together around this cause and calls on all local authorities to do so. He is proud, extremely proud of the unity and the collective local effort, and it's something that I very much agree with Ben on. So I do want to say well done to everyone in Inverclyde for making that difference to support our young people dealing with grief and bereavement. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McMillan. We move to the open debate. I call first Jamie Green to be followed by Rona Mackay. Around 4 minutes, Mr Green.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank Stuart McMillan for a very moving contribution this evening in the Chamber and excellent use of our time. Grief, as we all know, is a fact of life. Sometimes it is an event which is anticipated, perhaps through illness, but more than often it is unexpected or unforeseen. And I think the recent events, the last couple of years, really have brought that into sharp focus for many of us. It impacts us all as adults, but more so as children. I know from my own experience, having lost all my grandparents before I left high school, and even my father shortly after, grief really does affect people in very different ways. But loss at an early age, or such an early age, can be as confusing, I think, as it is unsettling. I really must also pay tribute to the Childhood Bereavement Network for the fantastic work that they do as an organisation who supports children at one of the most difficult points in their lives. I was struck by one particular phrase that came out of the Childhood Bereavement Network resource pack, and that phrase which comes up regularly is that of creating compassionate communities, and it is that phrase around which I want to base my contribution. As Stuart McMillan also said, I want to highlight the great work being done in Inverclyde. It really is leading the way when it it comes to creating that compassionate community. In fact, Inverclyde is the first place in Scotland to be included on the list of compassionate cities, according to the Public Health Palliative Care International Organisation, the only other place in the world being Taipei. And it's not because we have amazing organisations which can support people, like Cruise Bereavement Care, like the National Childhood Bereavement Network, or even more locally, Compassionate Inverclyde, who do great work through the local hospice. But it's because of individuals themselves who have suffered a great loss and have taken action, such as that of Ben Kane. I think his ambition of creating support groups for young people right across schools across Scotland is not just an incredible ambition, but I also think it's a realistic one too. And it's so important that we do so, because the study that Stuart McMillan mentioned, the statistic that over half of children in Scotland will have experienced bereavement of a close family member by the age of 8, really struck me. It's not a statistic I was aware of until I read this report. And that's before COVID. That number could very well have changed since then. Children who experience bereavement at such a young age can be more vulnerable to risks later in life. It's not just the loss of time at school during the event. It can lead to underachievement at school at one end of the spectrum, but also, more worryingly, depression, prolonged grief disorder, self-harm, and in some cases, sadly, even suicide at the other end of the spectrum. We also know statistically that children born into low-income families are 5 times more likely to lose a parent by the age of 10 than a child born into a wealthier family. The risk of losing a brother or sister at a young age was 4 times higher in the lowest income families as it is in higher income families. And I think that comes perhaps as no surprise to those of us in this chamber who have talked about these issues before. We know that issues around drug and alcohol-related deaths, suicide, mental health, mortal ill health and comorbidity are all things that we talk about regularly in this chamber. And we know that certain communities rank much higher in those sad lists, and Inverclyde sadly is one of those. But on a positive, I think what the survey did do is bring to the fore some clear recommendations that I think we should take on board, and I look forward to hearing the Minister's response. The three that struck out at me in the brief time that I have was that young people, I think, would benefit greatly from more death and grief literacy in the education curriculum, and by that I mean let's talk about death and grief in the right way in schools more often. It's still a taboo in many schools, and it's still too difficult to talk about for too many. The second point is that we also need to develop those stronger informal networks that Stuart McMillan talked about, not just parents and teachers, but peers and children themselves supporting each other. But the last and the final one that I would raise your attention to is that often grief-related services in Scotland are too often developed by adults for children, not actually based on the real-life experiences of children themselves and how their own tragedies and losses could help shape the future services for other young people. To me, that's what is at the heart of compassionate communities, and I hope that is what lies at the heart of this debate. Presiding Officer, thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bean. And I call Rona Mackay to be followed by Martin Whitfield. Around 4 minutes, Mr. Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Firstly, can I thank my colleague Stuart McMillan for bringing this very important debate to the Chamber, and thank Jamie for a really, really interesting contribution. The motion states that more than half of children in Scotland have experienced the bereavement of a close family member by the age of 8 and 62% by the age of 10. And like Jamie, those statistics really surprised and shocked me. These figures were published by the Children and Young People Centre for Justice in 2020 before the impact of COVID was known, so sadly those figures may be even higher. Presiding Officer, we know that bereavement and loss contributes to trauma and is counted as an adverse childhood experience. The Childhood Bereavement Network has done amazing work on this subject, and this year they've stated that the theme for 2023 is the shape of your support. Because supporting grieving children may come from those outside the family, as the wider family will in all likelihood be grieving themselves and may not be the best people for young people to turn to at an incredibly sensitive and sad time. I was really interested and encouraged to hear about the initiative by the Inverclyde Bereavement Network and former Clydeview Academy pupil Ben Kane, who set up a support group in the school for children who are dealing with bereavement. Ben has shown incredible maturity and courage in setting this up. As Stuart McMillan explained, he's held talks with Inverclyde Council about expanding the service to all Inverclyde schools. Presiding Officer, I really hope this initiative can go beyond Inverclyde and help grieving children in Eastern Bartonshire and my own constituency of Strathkelvin and Bearsden, indeed throughout all areas of Scotland. We have wonderful voluntary and third sector support networks in my constituency, and I'm sure this is something that would be welcomed. Indeed, the work of Child Bereavement UK and its National Development Coordinator for Scotland believes that working together could make a meaningful impact to Scotland's young people during what it considers to be such a difficult period in their lives. And we should remember too that bereavement often involves the death of a pet, which can be very traumatic for children and adults alike, and sensitive support and counselling should always be available for that experience. Depending on the age of a child, grief will be felt in a multitude of ways, and the Childhood Bereavement Network can provide professional and caring support in every case. Their excellent website is a source of valuable information and well worth visiting for anyone struggling to cope or support a young person. Presiding Officer, I cannot help but think about the children of Gaza and Israel at this terrible time of terrible conflict in the Middle East. I know I won't be alone in dreading watching and reading about the suffering of babies and children in that desperate war zone. Dazed children, frightened and confused, unable to comprehend why they've lost mums, dads, siblings in such a sudden, violent and incomprehensible way. They face a lifetime of trauma, and I hope with all my heart that support is there for them to help them heal. Their grief puts all of our problems into perspective. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I commend the work of the Childhood Bereavement Network, Child Bereavement UK, and indeed young Ben Kane for all the work that they're all doing to support young people experiencing grief. Grief is a part of life for everyone, young and old, and I'm heartened to see the focus on support and understanding, something that in the past was in short supply. So can I thank Stuart McMillan once again, and I look forward to hearing contributions from throughout the Chamber. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. And I call Martin Whitfield around 4 minutes. Mr Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it's a pleasure to follow Rona Mackay in this Members' debate, but also to follow on from, I can only echo what was said, the very powerful speech from Stuart McMillan about what we're addressing this evening. Because, of course, Children's Grief Awareness Week technically starts tomorrow on the 16th and runs through to next week, and I thank the Children's Bereavement Network for their work on this and around bereavement, but in particular to go back to the phrase of the Awareness Week, grief, because that's what we're talking about and how young people deal with it. And we've heard very powerful examples already about Ben Kane setting up the support, and because of the statistics we've already heard, it allows me to go back over the previous years with regard to Children's Grief Awareness Week, which began in 2019, when interestingly the network focused on young people who were lost for words. And I think the whole process over the years of this week carrying forward actually shows us a route about grief, that it would be helpful for all people, both not just to understand but also to remember. So beginning in 2019 with Lost for Words, in 2020 they moved to Say the Words, that most powerful moment when anybody, but particularly young people, can move that internal language of grief to something externally and express it. Sometimes for young people, particularly very young people, there aren't the words. And in saying the words, what you actually see are behavioural changes, which people with understanding, with training, indeed with empathy, can read into that it's not any malicious attempt from a young person, but it is a phrase we've heard frequently in this chamber, a cry for help, but one that comes from somewhere deep inside. In 2021, the network moved it to a word cloud of the thoughts, those internal feelings that young people have about grief and the difficulty it is to express it. And then in 2022, they came to the sharing shape, which again has been reflected this year. And indeed, if those people within the chamber and out with go to the website, they can see the mosaic that was created from the shape for last year. And I'm sure that this year's similar shapes will be incredibly powerful, because it speaks to what we've heard already, the very individual grief that people suffer, but also, most importantly, the support that stands around, be it from family, who may indeed also be suffering grief, from friends, who may have a challenge of understanding why their best friend or friend in their group is behaving the way they do, but the innate empathy of our young people comes through, to the charities that work around our young people, to the professionals that stand around our young people, and indeed to the wider community, that it sometimes would be helpful to remember that perhaps you don't understand what's going on in an individual's life, but you can still be kind, you can still care, and you can still ask them if they're all right. In the short time that we have, I would like to mention two groups that work with regard to bereavement. One is MyPass, a charity founded in Midlothian back in 1999, which has grown, but the charity originally came from the local community and now works on a whole diverse area supporting young people, particularly in the East Lothian schools, offering counselling, where particularly with regard to bereavement and grief, I've seen huge work done there. Because as I said earlier, sometimes children don't have the words to express it, but the feelings are inside. And actually, it might not be a quick solution. And I have seen the way that bereavement counsellors have worked sometimes for many months to allow a young person to get into a space where the grief doesn't vanish, but just like the shape that was chosen in sharing, they can build a wall around it and events in their lives put it into a proportion that makes it understandable. And the other group that I would need to make mention of is, of course, Barnardo's, who do a huge amount of work with regard to grief and bereavement and supporting not just our young community, but indeed our communities across Scotland and the UK. Can I once again compliment the Children's Grief Awareness Week starting tomorrow, and the shape of your support is shown in part by what we do here this evening. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Wakefield. I now invite Natalie Dawn to respond to the debate. Minister, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and to all members for taking part in this debate with some really, really thoughtful contributions this evening. I'd also like to thank Stuart McMillan for lodging this important motion, recognising Grief Awareness Week. I believe wholeheartedly that where children have suffered trauma and loss, they deserve appropriate support. Now, we know through research that bereavement during childhood can have significant and long-lasting effects on emotional, psychological and social well-being. Key impacts include struggling to understand and process emotions, leading to potential long-term issues. Childhood is a critical period for development, and the loss of a loved one can disrupt a child's developmental trajectory. It can affect their ability to form secure attachments, develop a sense of identity and navigate relationships with others. They may experience difficulties in school due to the emotional distress. They may have trouble concentrating, experience a decline in academic performance, and have difficulty interacting with peers and teachers. The loss of a loved one can lead to social isolation and withdrawal, struggling to engage in social activities, form new friendships, and maintain existing relationships. And this can further exacerbate those feelings of loneliness and grief. Childhood bereavement has also been linked to a higher risk of mental health issues in adulthood, and research concludes that it is crucial to provide timely, appropriate support and interventions to mitigate these possible long-term impacts. Now, I want to assure the Chamber that this is something that I take very seriously. I was 2 years old when I lost my dad, and there was very little support available at that time for me or my mum. And I think that's something that we need to remember. Support is really important for those around the child too, and I know that was something picked up on specifically in Martin Whitfield and Jamie Green's contributions. But what I really want to highlight here is that support isn't a one-stop shop. Support at 2 years old would have been really helpful, but there are numerous points in a child's life following a time like this where support could be required. And as a child growing up, it's extremely hard to deal with the loss of a parent, having to deal with questions from peers in school, and for me, the stigma that came with the death of a parent, and equally not having a clear understanding of why this happened to you, why you are the one who lost a parent. It's hard, and honestly, the lack of support that I received still impacts on me to this day. So I would therefore very much like to express my gratitude and appreciation for the bereavement support services in Scotland today, especially during challenging and unprecedented times such as the COVID-19 pandemic, as picked up by Stuart McMillan. These services play an invaluable role in providing comfort and guidance to children and their families who have experienced the profound loss of a loved one. I'm proud that since 2016, the Children, Young People and Families Early Intervention and Adult Learning and Empowering Communities Funds have provided funding of over $14 million annually to 115 organisations, including many of which have been named in the Chamber today, Child Bereavement UK, Richmond's Hope and Apex Scotland, who provide much needed support to children and young people who have suffered a loss through bereavement. And I thank members speaking in this debate who have highlighted the important work of these vital organisations. And another person I would like to highlight and thank, as have other members, is Ben Kane. As has been highlighted by, I believe, all members today, Ben's commitment to raising awareness and increasing support for those impacted by bereavement has been admirable. The support group set up by Ben offers a safe place for people to find comfort and talk about their grief, and I really welcome this important work, and I'm sure many, many people, young people, have found this extremely helpful. Now, the Scottish Government recognises that bereavement can affect many aspects of our lives, and so it reaches across many different ministerial portfolios. Therefore, we've set up a cross-policy bereavement network, which aims to support a more joined-up approach, be more strategic across existing and planned government action, and provide a single point of access for bereavement partners. This will ensure that there is collective ministerial responsibility to ensure that those experiencing bereavement are able to access the support that they need and require. In 2020, we established the National Childhood Bereavement Coordinator to look at the range of bereavement services available for young people across Scotland. And this work was carried out over a two-year period, and a final report with recommendations for improvement was published in September 2022. Now, following this, the Scottish Bereavement Summit was held on the 13th of October, and the final report of the summit was published in June and made 10 recommendations, as has been touched upon. Now, these were based on the recommendations from the Childhood Bereavement Coordinator and four previous bereavement reports, and the Scottish Government welcomes these reports and acknowledges the huge amount of work and collaboration that has gone into developing these and the focus it brings to improving the experience of those affected by grief and loss. I understand Stuart McMillan and other members are looking for an update on the recommendations on the report. I can confirm that the Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport has agreed to meet with three key bereavement stakeholders on the 14th of December 2023. And in advance of this, the Scottish Government Bereavement Cross-Policy Network will continue to engage with the bereavement sector as we consider how to best take forward those findings. As a government, we will continue to engage with and listen to the bereavement sector, and I am very, very clear that we require a collaborative approach to supporting those who have suffered bereavement. And I really hope that by sharing my own personal experience, members will appreciate that I fully understand the importance of ensuring that this support is available when it is required, and my commitment to this. Presiding Officer, I'd like to close by reiterating my thanks to all members here today for this important debate and to Stuart McMillan for bringing it to the Chamber this evening. Thank you.
Well done, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.